Last night's statement from the 12, then the 13, and now the 15 intelligence chiefs and deputies was followed late today by a statement from 60 other former intelligence professionals. I just want to highlight a few of those names and their accomplishments so you could get a better sense of the caliber and the sacrifice and the service of these men and women. Let's start with Greg Vogel. He's the former CIA deputy director for operations. He was in charge of covert ops, and he's credited with saving the life of the Afghan president Hamid Karzai during a friendly fire strike in Afghanistan just after 9/11. Remember that. There is Letitia Long. She's the former director of the National Geospatial Intelligence Agency. She's the first woman to head a U.S. intelligence agency. There is the highly decorated Jeremy Bash, and there is also CNN counterterrorism analyst Phil Mudd, long history in counterterrorism, who joins us now, along with CNN political commentator Paris Dennard. Phil, since you are one of those who signed your name to that list, the second letter coming from former intelligence officials today, tell me why you and your colleagues went public today challenging, protesting the president's actions.
I don't understand, Jim, why we keep talking about security clearances. This is not about security clearances. My peers on that letter spent our lives. I joined in 85 fighting countries, the North Koreans, looking at other adversaries or potential adversaries, the Chinese, the Russians. These countries, one of the common characteristics they have is people who want to speak out because they have views that don't correspond with the views of government are either sidelined or, in some cases, if you look at Vladimir Putin, murdered. This is not about security clearances. This is about the president trying to intimidate people to say, you're a dog and I'll muzzle you. We spent our career saying that we're fighting for the right of 330 million Americans to speak, and the president said no. That will never happen in this country. All of us will speak until we are dragged away. I don't care what I say. I don't care what John Brennan says. I have the right to say it. I don't care whether the president likes it or not, if it's Bush, if it's Obama, if it's Trump, I have the right to say it. That's the reason we wrote that letter.
Paris, let me ask you, longtime Trump supporter, who should the American people trust? Who should the American people listen to on this issue? 75 men and women like that who have served and continue to serve their country, who have served both Republican and Democratic presidents, I might add, or the president on this. Who's right?
Well, I think they are both right. I think that
the president's trying to silence them. How could one, in this case, one has to be right, because they're saying the president was wrong to remove the security clearance under threat of taking away people's voice here.
What we have seen since John Brennan's security clearance has been revoked is that nobody's voice has been silenced. Mr. Cohen came on your program, said whatever he wanted to. Others have come on and said exactly what they want to. They continue to be contributors on cable news. They continue to tweet as they wish. Phil Mudd came on this program tonight and said he won't be silenced. So the idea that somehow revoking their security clearance is going to silence them is not true.
So
they're still talking.
Why is the president doing it? To what end?
I think what we have to look at is the idea of norms and laws and privileges and rights. And these are all getting confused under this administration with people thinking that because something was a norm means that it's law. That's not the case. A lot of these people that have these security clearances, and this is the secret in the swampy Washington, D.C., they have them and they keep them because it's profitable for them after they leave government. Because if you have a security clearance, especially high-level security clearances, your contracts and your consulting gigs pay you a lot more money because of the access that you have. I hope the president continues to do this, and I hope he adds Omarosa to the list, because if she has a clearance, she too, because of her actions, should have it revoked.
Well, I don't know if I'd put Omarosa in the same category of the 75 people who signed those letters, but Phil Mudd, I imagine you wanted to react.
Profitable, Paris. When I am requested to sit on an advisory board, let me ask you one question. How much do you think I'm paid to do that at the request of the U.S. government? Give me one answer, and you got 10 seconds. How much?
I'll ask you a question. How much are you paid for your
consulting
and contracting gigs? for being a for
I have no contract with the U.S. government that pay money.
I'm not talking
zero.
And this is the thing.
When
I'm not talking
when
about
I'm asked
the
to offer advice to the U.S. government,
Phil,
I get paid
honest.
Zero.
Phil, let's be
That's
honest.
It.
I'm not talking about your role with the federal government. I'm talking about the contracts and gigs that
you get
from
being
a consultant and a contractor. The consulting firms that they form and that you all get is because you get more money when having a consultant for having the security clearance.
That
Stop
is
acting
incorrect.
Like that doesn't happen.
I have
That's
zero consulting relationships with the U.S. government. Zero.
I'm not talking, Phil, that's a good talking point. I'm not talking about relationships with the government. I'm talking about in the private sector. When you have a security clearance and you keep it.
I have zero relationships with the private sector that involve my security clearance. Zero. I get $0 from consulting companies that deal with the U.S. government. Are we clear?
Well, I will be clear in saying that everybody in Washington, D.C. knows if you don't want to be honest about it, that's on you. But if you have a security clearance and you keep it, you
We're
get
done,
more
Jim.
Money to
We're
have
done.
It.
We're done. Get out.
Phil,
it's not your show, so I'm staying
years
right
in the service
here.
And this is
Don't
the
be
shit
so defensive about
Get
this.
Out.
Don't be so defensive about this. Well, your voice is still here. You can still do whatever you want.
Let's
but the politicalization of the intelligence community under this administration, with the people coming on here every day, tweeting and talking about this administration, you all have made it about politics, the president.
Let's take a beat here for a second. And Phil, I appreciate your patience because I know it's getting personal here. Paris, I do a point of fact here.
It's all right.
And Phil
it's
makes
right.
a point, which is a point of fact. When a Phil Mudd, who serves on an advisory board for counterterror threats, goes and participates in conversations mm-hmm. at the agency about those threats, he's not getting paid for that.
And that's all
when
I'm talking
Bill
about.
When Bill McRaven is consulted on counterterror operations because he led dozens of missions, deadly missions,
Absolutely.
Where soldiers risk their lives, he's not paid for that.
And we
you are what you seem to be doing here
no.
is saying that because people have jobs outside of government, after they leave government, that therefore you're saying that is justification to take away their clearances when government and agencies rely on them for their counsel? Is that what you're arguing?
What I'm arguing, Jim, is that, and I appreciate every one of those persons' service, and I know how important everyone in the intelligence community serving currently and the past are in the role that they play for this country. But what I'm talking about is the private sector. Let's not act like all these men and women sit at home all day and just consult with the federal government and don't earn a living. Everybody knows, Jim, that a part of keeping your clearance means you get more money for having the clearance. When you consult and when you have contracts with other companies and when you set up your own firms, this is what happens.
Phil, he's making an argument there, and you've made your point on what you do for government. What's your response to Paris's argument here?
Well, we got 24 hours. I got a simple suggestion. Go to the original 15 signatories of the letter yesterday and ask how much income by a percentage they make from their security clearances. Mine, zero. Thanks a lot.
Here's a question I want to put to you, Paris, because it gets to the larger issue here. Mm-hmm. This is a question of national security, is it not? You keep security clearances when you leave the profession because you may be called on to give advice based on your experience when the U.S. faces a national security threat, as Phil does when he's called in when, for instance, there's a new threat to bringing bombs on airplanes, right? They call Phil in to say, how can we use your experience to prevent bombs from going on airplanes? As an American, would you feel safer if that counsel was not available to the President of the United States?
What I would hope, Jim, is that there's a mechanism so that if called upon and if needed, the individuals that served prior could come back and do it on a temporary
basis. That's exactly what this
could
is.
Do it on
now, to be clear, because there's a misunderstanding. I don't know if you know, just for the sake of our viewers, to have a clearance doesn't mean that David Cohen can walk into the CIA any day and call up classified files. It means that if he's called upon, he is already cleared to go into that building and view classified information. So the system you're talking about is exactly the system that's in place, which is exactly the system that the president here is removing by removing their security clearances. Does that change your view?
Well, Jim, let's be honest. He's not eliminating the entire system.
What he's doing it for a bunch of prominent people.
What he's doing is for those people who have been overtly political or for those people whom the president believes have done things that have been political as it relates to the Russia investigation and didn't do a good job in that early on, or being sitting here calling the president, saying he's committed treason or calling him treasonous, by utilizing the intelligence information that they have, saying that they're qualifying their position and calling the president treasonous because of the access that they have, the president is saying, you people on this list should not have that security clearance. Why do we think that these people are the only ones that can provide this intelligence? This is a large intelligence community out there.
These are the directors and deputy directors from the last 25 years. They're pretty well qualified if you look in the last 25 years.
And there's a lot more people that were just under them that are equally as qualified and that can provide that same level of intelligence.
Phil Mott, I'm going to give you a quick final word.
May I say one more thing? Michael Flynn, the former director of the Defense Intelligence Agency, got on the campaign trail and asked that a political opponent be locked up, what a third world dictatorship does. If the question, if the litmus test is whether someone in intelligence gets involved in politics, why did the president ask him to be national security advisor instead of suggesting that his security clearance be removed? I want to hear the answer to that.
And on that point, we researched this today, and CNN reported earlier today, Michael Flynn's security clearance has been suspended but not revoked. It remains suspended since he pleaded guilty, to lying to federal investigators. Phil Mudd, Paris Dennard, thanks very much for the conversation. It's a difficult one, but we appreciate you joining us.